Britain on the brink of a shale gas revolution? Will it help kickstart the economy like it did in the US? What are the myths and what's the truth about the real benefits of shale gas? Let's discuss it with Richard Sarsfield-Hall, Senior Principal at Pöyry Management Consulting. Richard, thank you for being with us today.
Good morning.
Pöyry is Europe's leading energy management consultancy. So tell me about your clients. You have one that's been in the press a lot recently, Quadrilla.
Yes, Quadrilla is one of our clients. We did some work for them last year. We've also done some work on shale gas for Ofgem, which was some work we published in 2011. And we're currently doing some work for the Organisation for Gas Producers, which is an umbrella, worldwide umbrella body. And we're doing some work for them this year. And I should also mention that we published a Pöyry Point of View, which is a public report at the end of last year, which looked at what the impact of the Lancashire shale gas developments might be on the UK.
There are lots of myths about the impact shale gas development in the UK will have on prices. So tell me, will it really help collapse gas prices like many people expect?
Well, certainly our view is that it won't lead to a collapse on prices. And that's primarily because, unlike America, where they've become self-sufficient with gas, and the shale gas has helped to make that happen, Britain is connected to the worldwide gas market via LNG and via pipelines to Europe and, of course, to Russia. And those prices will not be directly impacted in the same way. So any shale gas developed here is not going to have such a big impact. That said, if you were the Treasury, then you might be much more interested in that. Of course, anything developed here improves the balance of payments, and that's definitely a benefit to the economy as a whole.
And what will the impact of shale gas development be on renewables and the nuclear energy industry?
Well, a lot of people seem to assume that if you have one, you can't have the other. Again, our research says that that's not the case. Shale gas would, at most, produce about, say, 25% of what's needed in the UK. So, and that link on prices with not being collapsed means that you wouldn't see a mass reduction of other forms of generation. As you know, renewables and nuclear need a lot of support to make them cost competitive against fossil fuels anyway going forward, and that support will still need to be invested. And there's no reason to assume that money going into shale gas is going to displace any money that goes into renewables or to nuclear development.
And what's the real state of shale gas reserves in the UK? Obviously, recently there's been a lot of press coverage about the potential in the Bowlands area of the northwest of the UK, and it's obviously greater than expected.
Well, there's lots of risks and barriers to development, but in terms of the what's actually going to be able to be developed, I think we have to draw some positive expectations. Company like Centrica, by investing in Bowland, will obviously have had an opportunity to see the exploration test well results, and therefore must have some belief that there is going to be economically feasible reserves that can be recovered, at least from that site. The one area that makes it much more attractive compared to lots of people's concerns is that the shale gas is very, very thick in depth when you actually get down to that level. So that means from one sort of drilling pad, you can develop a lot of shale gas rather than having to do the one and done, which is the traditional technique that's used in North America.
What are the development risks or hurdles for the shale gas industry?
Three main ones. First one's obviously the political, which of course we just talked about. There are benefits to the economy as a whole, and the government's given some various tax incentives to do that, but of course future governments might not do that. Second one is the actual process of doing that relating to permitting and getting the planning permission through. That's a very slow process. At the moment, that's all managed locally. And if you have to keep on doing that for every single well that you do and each piece of infrastructure, then that could become very, very time consuming and doing else. And of course, lastly but not least, is the environmental concerns, which is will there be enough swell of environmental concerns with an environmental lobby process that actually makes the politicians change their mind in terms of the support that they're prepared to give. There's a lot of, again, myths associated with that one, a lot of people saying that it's very dangerous, a lot of evidence has been disproved, but it doesn't stop the process actually being propagated that there are real risks to water supplies, etc.
So which companies will really benefit from this shale gas boom if it does materialise?
Well, of course, there are the small companies. There's the other potential developers around the place, so people like Egdon Resources, Reach, others who've got different things around the UK. But probably the biggest benefits will be for sort of engineering and equipment manufacturers, especially those who are already involved in that North Sea oil capability that we've got. So they're used to fabricating drilling wells, pipe works, all the other equipment that goes with this type of activity. And in many ways, this will help keep those industries and those companies going at a level that they otherwise wouldn't have done because of the decline in the North Sea that's currently ongoing. So this would help give them a boost and keep their employment and their technical skills going much longer than it otherwise might have done.
Richard, thank you very much. That was Richard Sarsfield-Hall, Senior Principal at Pöyry Management Consulting.